talk about cap, that parcel there hits those warmer layers, and now it is cooler, the air is cooler than those warmer layers, so it stops rising and it spreads out beneath the cap. On days when you see the clouds kind of billowing, and they reach a level and they kind of flatten out, then spread out and form kind of a blanket, those are days where we have typically inversions or caps in the atmosphere. So, to punch through that warmer layer, it requires us either to cool that inversion layer or increase the instability, the temperature below it. It requires additional heating below it, the cooling of the warm layer, or a stronger forcing mechanism, a stronger front or disturbance within the atmosphere to lift. What are some ways that we can lift air in the atmosphere? Well, just through heating at the lower levels of the atmosphere, we can create what we call convective processes, local convective processes. We heat the atmosphere in the lower levels, the air will rise, and as I mentioned, continue to rise, but it's no longer warmer than the surrounding environment. That's one way, just heating the lower levels of the atmosphere. Cold fronts are another way. The dry line out in West Texas is another way. Occasionally the dry line can get eastward into this area. It's kind of rare. It's usually more a focus out in West Central Texas. Usually it's going to be some cold front that lifts the air. So this is kind of a three-dimensional view of the cold front that you're looking at. And the cold air is more dense than warmer air, so the warmer air gets shoved over the colder air. You're lifting air above the cold, dense air behind the cold front. So that's a way we can lift air. Low pressure systems in the lower middle levels of the atmosphere. Air converging into one point has to go somewhere when it gets to the middle of the low, it's usually upward. And there can be terrain influences. We can see local influences along the leading edge of the hill country, and obviously the edge of the escarpment, about Cummings Escarpment, that can assist sometimes during the spring months and sometimes during the fall months with lifting air. And that fourth ingredient that we talk about in the basic class, wind shear, is typically the fourth ingredient we look for to turn that ordinary storm, that whole storm, into severe. So, wind shear, just to kind of define again, what we learned in the basic class, there's two types of wind shear. Wind shear is defined as an increase with wind speed as you go up in the atmosphere, and or a change in direction as you go up into the atmosphere. We can measure wind shear in the atmosphere, and you typically see these in our forecast discussion. We'll talk about deep layer shear, so we'll average the wind shear from the surface up to 6 kilometers in the atmosphere, and you may hear us say deep layer shear that day is 40 to 50 knots. That's typically a pretty good number that we need to start tilting those up drafts. Lower wind shear values of maybe 20 or 30 knots might not be able to get severe storms. Just like Cape, the higher amounts of wind shear you see referenced can indicate the rate of potential for severe weather. You can see wind shear in the atmosphere. We saw it in some of the previous visual clues that you should look for. And you see tilted updraft. So the first two things we like to tell spotters we're going to look for in a storm is, where's the rain-free base? Next to the second thing, where is it raining? The rain-free base is the air going up into the storm. The rain is the air coming down into the storm. So rain-free base, updraft, rain, downdraft. If you're out away from the storm and you found the rain-free base and you follow the rain-free base up and it is tilted with height, you have wind shear in the atmosphere. Here's an